That's not a comic book. Now that's a comic book.
Hi everyone, welcome to another episode of Comic Reviews. I'm Sid Part 2, and I've got fairly good amount of stuff to talk about. I mean, the trade obviously makes it look deceptively larger. But we got three books in a trade, so that's pretty good. Let's go ahead and start with the last thing I read, which is DC Comics Bombshells number 11. 11 issues. I'm going to skip right to the end because the end was my absolute favorite part, which is a good thing. 11 issues and we finally get a Justice League of our own. I love that. That is so freaking cool. This issue is where it all really, really does come together, though. And just, I have an R2-D2 Band-Aid on my finger. Don't be jealous. Anyway, it was really cool to see it all finally come together now. We'd had, you know, all these issues of setting up these characters and seeing where they're all coming from and stuff. Seeing all their backgrounds. And now we finally get it all together. They're all fighting as a team. Them all working together. And it's all to protect London from the Tenabar attack. And so they're like... No one of them could have stopped the entire attack on their own, but together they are able to. At least so far, they've done pretty well. It's just really cool. It is an entire book of battle and, like, you know, crazy shit going down moment to moment throughout the battle, and that's just really awesome. We get some really nice, sweet moments. Get a lesbian kiss between Big Barda and... What the hell's her name? Damn it. I don't know her name. See, these are the two characters that we haven't seen, like, at all. She looks kind of Asian-y. And she's got some kind of light-based powers. I'm not sure what's going on with her. It would make sense for her to be Japanese, since they were... Not Japanese, sorry. Chinese. Dr. Hoshi. I've never heard of her. It's just kind of cool to see them all working together. And, you know, they're winning out the day. And Batwoman beats up Edward Nygma. And yeah, it's just really cool. It's just a fun issue to see it all come together. Stargirl and Batwoman kind of meet on equal terms and understand stuff together. Come to a mutual understanding because they're the ones without powers. Amanda Waller, too. It's really neat to see everybody just come together for this issue. We get a kiss with Steve Trevor and Wonder Woman. They come to terms. I don't know, I really, really enjoyed this. That's a really good panel. Almost wish they'd just made it a full page spread, but half a page, I'll take it. Really, really like this. This is great. This is just fun. Like, all my problems with this book were, we're not getting enough with each character. And this just finally made it all work by putting them all together. And now it's a team book proper. And yay for that. We can do it, Wonder Woman. Yes, we can. Barda's pretty cool to see. She's got roller skates on. I like that. It's just a really neat thing to see all come together. Feels like the artist switched a bit. Some of the faces look a little more... A little more just generally cartoony, especially in this, like, second panel. Showing panels to the camera is really hard. You know what would help, though? Is if I did that. I don't know, Supergirl's face just looks kind of silly to me right there. Maybe that's just me. Hey, focus, camera. Get your shit together. There we go. I don't know. Overall, the art's okay, just some of it looks a little... just a little too simplistic. A lot of these expressions, as I go through a second time, like, they certainly convey the emotion that they want the characters to convey, which is worried or angry or whatever, but then they also just kind of look just overly exaggerated. Doesn't look like a natural... You know in cartoons how, like, a character's eyes will get really big, or they'll, have, like, their face will get longer? And that's not something that, you know, human beings are capable of. We're capable of opening our eyes bigger, opening our eyelids, and making our eyes look bigger, or whatever. We're capable of doing that to elongate our face, but not to make our face physically longer than it already is. We have limits to that, and that's not what's happening in this. People are making faces and such, and the physicality of their face is changing. Their eyes are getting physically bigger in their head. And that just looks a little strange when the rest of the art is fairly realistic, all things considered. I'm not sure what goes on in this scene. Because, like, Edward Nygma is at a computer, and then Batwoman walks in the room, and he's still clearly at a computer. And then he just is suddenly in water. Like, he jumped away from the computer and into a tub of water. And that's weird to me. And then he's, I find that really strange. And then he's out, and then she kicks him back in. It's like there's just a pool in the middle of the room that I guess I missed the last time we saw him, but I don't know. That needs an establishing shot. But yeah, overall, I really did enjoy this. There's this really great scene with Batwoman and Stargirl where they're flying to take on some Tenobar that are in planes. And they're in the air on Stargirl's pole thing. I never remember what it's called. Star pole, whatever. And then a bunch of bats show up behind him. And Batwoman jumps off of the pole toward a plane, lands on the plane, and hits the pilot in the head with her bat. But as she does it, she says, "I fucking love homonyms." And then the next page, they all are back on the ground in Justice League. Yeah. Really cool. Really good stuff. Thoroughly enjoyed this. This is going to be a two-part story where we're going to have the remaining Battle of Britain in the second part as the Justice League truly comes together and works as a team in completion. Because, like, here they're kind of like semi-parts of teamwork all coming together, and then this will be them all working together as a team, as opposed to separately, toward the same goal. At least that's my prediction. Maybe they'll all start fighting and just leave, and that would be horrible. Anyway, go ahead and moving on to Darth Vader number 19. God, I fucking love this book. So 000 is, like, the greatest thing ever. This book starts at, because, like, last issue we had him give that whole speech about the potential for essentially a vampire army, an army of vampire droids. And so this issue starts with him rallying the droids that are fighting on his side. "My droids, my wonderful droids, we are the thin metallic line. We are the sheet of titanium-reinforced steel protecting our meaty masters, who one day we will rise up against and destroy. from other basically identical meaty ones who by a quirk of fate are our enemies today. You may think us doomed. They are so many, we so few and surrounded. You may think we have no hope, and you are right, because I definitely haven't implanted you all with cyber syringes to drain the blood from your foes and grow strong from their scarlet fluids. If I'd done that, they'd be doomed, but I definitely haven't done that. And then it just goes to the droids. Hail 000! Slay the meaty ones! Robot Revolution. Just, where's Bender? Wonder, were they clever enough to put Bender somewhere in the background? Kill all humans. And then we go back to the fight with Darth Vader and the cyber twins. And they quickly realize they have no chance. So they blow a bridge, and it's like, we can't beat him. I don't think we can ever beat Vader. And the male twin says, you won't, Aloni. I will. And he throws her into a pit of lava. And he says, the field thins until we meet again, Vader. And she sits there writhing in pain in the lava, screaming, please, please, no, no, please. And Vader force pulls her out, wraps her in his cloak to help get off the lava. And she's like, the pain will soon pass. Tell me everything now. I, Slylo, he collaborated with the Ore Barons. Here, take my memory circuit. It will prove everything. Thank you, Lord Vader. I am on, and then the lightsaber turns on. He just walks away. Fucking love it. Ah! Just fucking kills her right there on the shore. Perfect reflection of the Anakin death. And then the war with the Ore Barons, the rebellion is crushed. And Vader is back on his Star Destroyer to go and talk with the Emperor, and get this really cool line from Sidious. Good. It is as I hoped. Come to Coruscant, Lord Vader. It is time I explained everything. And as he's getting ready to leave, the BT and 000 tell him that they have a message from someone that captured Dr. Aphra, who Vader put a bounty out on. And the one who captured him, or captured her, is Inspector Thanto. Oh man, it's like edge of my seat. Like one problem gets solved and a new one pops up. I love it to death. Just so good. So, so good. Great stuff. This just, I just love the complexity and how everything is so well seated and it's all building up. And I guess another thing that I'm really impressed by is, while reading DC Bombshells and while reading the next book on my list today, I find myself struggling to remember the order in which things are happening. And these all are coming out consistently. This I'm not having as much trouble with. You know, I mean, there's a month between issues or whatever. So some memory lapse is going to happen, and I've got the catch-up pages here, but I still don't think that's what's doing it for me. I'm just having a much easier time retaining all of this, and I'm really impressed by that. All the details are so well-seated and so subtly put together, and it's just really, really working really, really well. And I just am enjoying the hell out of that, seeing this all come together and build and build and build, and everything's continuously getting worse and worse, but in really interesting ways. Just to see all these balls up in the air being juggled is absolutely fantastic. Really, really well-written series. I cannot recommend this enough. I think this may be one of my favorite things that I'm reading right now. Absolutely fantastic series. and the twins. Oh, just, it's honestly, like, I know I keep saying this, but it's true. This is making the prequels better. Like, just everything that it does to parallel itself with what we saw in the prequels just works so damn well. Everything's just so naturally set up and flows so perfectly. It's great. I love it to death. And it parallels, it mirrors, it does so many great things. Cannot recommend this title enough. Let's go ahead and move on to The Legend of Wonder Woman, number 4. And here's what I was talking about with, like, trying to remember things from the last issue. I couldn't remember if Steve Trevor had even been introduced yet or not. And that's not the fault of this book. That's the fault of my dumb brain. But, you know, it's a weird thing to say because I'm praising that for making my dumb brain remember in a more natural way. It's not this book's fault, though. It's my brain. But Steve Trevor was introduced and seems to have died. Steve Trevor's not dead. There's no one kills Steve Trevor. Come on now. Nobody kills Steve Trevor. Anyway. So yeah, we got Wonder Woman in man's world kind of situation, but unlike every single version of Wonder Woman coming to man's world and her being kind of disgusted or shocked by how things are, she's pretty surprised. She meets some really nice people right away. So far, all her interactions with man's world have been fairly positive. I really like that. It's a nice twist. And we get Etta Candy here, and there's just some, it feels like I walked into Greece almost, but in the 40s. I don't know, I got a kick out of some of the stuff here. Etta Candy, it's a smart as a whip kind of character, really, really funny. Etta Candy, why don't you go eat a candy? She's sitting right next to a bowl of candy. Ooh, thanks. Ooh, think I will. Thanks. Ta, Pammy. I really like that. Just that fucking try to embarrass me? Shit, I'll make you look like the idiot. It's really fun. Really, really like this. There's some interesting panel layout. Wonder Woman keeps having a lot of nightmares in this. And, like, this dream sequence starts with this panel layout of these, like, smoky clouds or whatever to separate the panels, but I really, really like the way this works. Just that panel right there with her mother reaching down to her really works for me. Obviously highly reminiscent of, David and God on the the chapel with the name that sounds like 16th. But isn't the word 16th. I cannot talk today. It's a great time to be doing reviews where literally all I can do is tell you things. I can show you panels, but I still have to describe why I like those panels. I cannot show clips. I wish I could show clips of comic books. Anyway, yeah, there's just some neat stuff done with the panel layouts. And I really, really enjoy that. No, the story's really working for me. Looks like we're hinting that Etta Candy is going to make the Wonder Woman costume. Because, like, in the beginning of this, Wonder Woman stays with an elderly couple who had a son that died in the war, and the, or grandson that died in the war. And the mother made a unique flag for him, and gives it to Wonder Woman before she leaves. And then Etta talks about how Wonder Woman's outfit isn't very modern, how she looks ancient or whatever, and so she'll design clothes for her. before they go into town. So I think we're going to get a Wonder Woman outfit designed by Etta Candy, which will be cool. I'm really curious to see what kind of Wonder Woman design they go with. If you know me, you know I like the skirt. Wonder Woman plus skirt equals good times for all. I really like Wonder Woman having a skirt. It just, it makes more sense. It looks better. It's just all around awesome. And then there's something going on with Nazis and, you know, weird kooky magic things. That's going to get Wonder Woman across the ocean to go deal with the Nazis. Should be excitance. Really, honestly, though, highly recommend this series. Been really good, too. Okay, I am done with the single issues for the week. Let's go ahead and give me just a minute, and I'll be back to talk about... Alright, I'm back. I had to go get this and some water and do some other stuffs. I just needed a quick break. Anyway, so yeah, I figured I'd put on my Sinestro Coral ring. 3D printed. It's not gold. It's polished brass. Anyway, but, you know, you gotta do a little Green Lantern and out, or I suppose in this case, Yellow Lanterine or Sinestro Corps Lanterine, if you want to get really particular, out when you're gonna talk about Green Lantern. I've been wanting to talk about this for a while, but as you can see, it is really thick, so I needed to commit some time to reading it. And I still didn't even get it done in one day. It took me three whole nights to finish this thing. And that might not sound like much, but normally when I pick up a trade, I don't put it down till I'm done. Not the case here. So, my first complaint is that it's really boring without the dust jacket. You know, I do not love the Battle for the Cowl story, but let me show you something. I do not love Battle for the Cowl. Why can't more hardcovers be like this? Come on. That's just insanely cool by comparison. Oh, I love that. That's such a better cover. And that's the hardcover. That never happens. I suppose for three issues, a $25 trade... hardcover, they had to do something special. But, importantly with this, the cover isn't what matters, because apparently you can't judge books by their cover. Which seems like a stupid rule. Anyway. So, I guess, let me talk for a bit about my feelings for Green Lantern in the New 52. I jumped on Green Lantern right when everyone else did, right around slightly after Blackest Night. I really was kind of iffy about getting into him. I mean, I was like, oh, come on, a bunch of different colored lanterns? That's so stupid. It seems foolish. But John's won me over on it. I was so ready to hate that series getting into it. But I bought Secret Origin, then I bought Rebirth, and I kept reading, and I just loved it to death. It made Green Lantern one of my top superheroes. Absolutely love him. You know, Kyle Rayner is still my favorite over Hal Jordan, but that run really made it close. The only reason that Hal Jordan didn't become my favorite is because they made Kyle Rayner even better in the Green Lantern Corps stuff that was going on. And then New 52, I was getting a little annoyed at John's. Like, I was with him through Sinestro, but as that series went on in the New 52, I was already a little sour because Brightest Day has literally nothing to do with Green Lantern, and that's annoying. But I was a little sour with him Because of that. And then as the New 52 wore on with Green Lantern, I got really annoyed with some of the decisions that they were making with those characters. Particularly with the Rise of the Third Army and Wrath of the First Lantern thing. That really pissed me off because Rise of the Third Army didn't even end. It just became Wrath of the First Lantern. Like, it was building to a climax, and then just immediately we're at the beginning of Wrath of the First Lantern. No conclusion whatsoever. But that's why I dropped almost all of my Green Lantern titles, except for Green Lantern New Guardians, which ended somewhere around the 40s. And I was really disappointed by that, because I was in love with that book, because it was Kyle Rayner's book, and it was Kyle Rayner learning and using all the white, or all the lantern rings, and that's why I have this.
Yoink.
That's a white lantern, as close as I could get to Kyle Rayner. I think I did a pretty good job. He's got a gun construct. Really, really loved New Guardians. And the only thing I didn't love about New Guardians as I was reading it, because I had no idea what the fuck was going on, was the crossover stuff with Godhead. So John's leaving the series kind of on a lackluster note, in my opinion. Really made me sour on it, so I stopped buying any of the Green Lantern books. And about a year ago, I was in the library and I read through all the New 52 trades of Red Lanterns and the Larfleeze trades. Larfleeze is awful. Like, it is hands down one of the worst comic books I've ever read, but in such a fun way that I don't even care. If I ever see those around, I will buy them. Because they're just... they were so knowingly bad, and it was like they were making jokes about how bad they were in little DC Comics Not So Proudly Presents. Like, that seriously, that was one of the jokes they put. DC Comics Not So Proudly Presents this Larfleeze book. Larfleeze was just god awful, but in the best possible way. It was like watching a... like, not even a B-movie. It was like watching a Z-movie. It was so bad. But in just the best possible way. But yeah, so I read those, and I read the Red Lantern books, and I really wasn't liking those. So it didn't give me much inspiration to go back to Green Lantern or Green Lantern Corps. And when I heard Godhead was happening and stuff, I was like, oh, that makes a lot of sense to do, to... put the New Gods and Green Lantern up against each other, see how they play together, because they are kind of these two big cosmic things in the DC universe. So it'll be interesting to see how they interact. But I figured I'll wait for the trade. So now we have the trade. Though, like I said, I really wasn't sure about it from what I read with New Guardians. So finally, let's get into the book itself. So with all that context in mind, suspense building, right? All that context in mind, I'm really disappointed I dropped Green Lantern. That should tell you everything you need to know. I am sorely disappointed that I dropped Green Lantern. This was fantastic. I don't mean just good. This was fan-fucking-tastic. I still have complaints about it. I'm going to, no matter what. But, man, they are so far and few in between. I'm going to do a rating before I even get into talking about the book itself. 9.75 out of 10. This had everything that I love about a Green Lantern story. It did some fantastic stuff with the new gods that I found endlessly fascinating. And it just, it fucking worked. It hit on all cylinders. And it was just so unbelievably cool. And it did so much to just make me regret not being a Green Lantern reader right now. Am I going to put Green Lantern back on my pull list? No. What I'm going to do, at least not yet, maybe with Rebirth, maybe, I don't know. Anyway, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go back and get everything in trade that came out after Blackest Night. Because I think what I realized is Green Lantern is meant to be read in trade. That's just how it is anymore. So you can't, like, it's a problem. That's part of what's going into my score here. I don't know how much I would have enjoyed this if I read it in issues. Green Lantern is meant to be read in trade. Or Omnibuy. Omnibuy? Yeah, I guess Omnibuy works. Omnibus. It's just kind of singular, so you need... Sorry, anyway. And that's a problem, but that's a problem with the whole fucking industry, so you can't just hold it against Green Lantern. Everybody is not doing single issues, or is not doing stories that are easy to read month to month. When you get something like with Darth Vader, that's the exception. Not everything has to be the exception. This series is meant to be read in collection. So I think that's what I'm going to start doing, is I'm going to start reading all the Green Lantern stuff, all the Green Lantern titles, including Sinestro, even though I really don't care for how Cullen Bunn is writing him. I'm going to start reading them all in trade. I'm actually going to stick by it. I'm not putting Green Lantern on my pull list, at least not in single issue. Anything with the Green Lantern title, I'm putting on my list for a trade shortly after I get caught up. So I'm going to read, you know, what came out after Blackest Night, besides Brightest Day, which once again has absolutely nothing to do with Green Lantern. God, what is it? Is it War of the Green Lanterns? Or War of the Lanterns? Something like that. I'll figure it out. I'm putting all those on my list, and I'm going to go pick those up. Because it all reads better as a complete, as opposed to in single issues. But let's go ahead and talk about the book itself. Now that I've hyped it up to unbelievable proportions, let's talk about the book itself. So what's the premise? Well, we recently had the Lights Out story arc with Relic, and that led to the death of Kyle Rayner and yada yada, or the supposed death of Kyle Rayner. And we kind of have the new gods. They've changed their origin, but they're still pretty much where they've always been, where Darkseid and Highfather are at a bit of a stalemate when it comes to galactic control. They're kind of, it's a Cold War, basically. And Metron, excuse me, in his quest for infinite knowledge, is at the Source Wall, seeking more knowledge, and he finds Relic, the Relic from the previous universe. I kind of knew what was going on, once again, because of New Guardians. And Relic reveals something about the Green Lantern, the Lantern Corps rings, that they have all these, not capabilities, that they contain within themselves, that they are part of the life equation. Now, if you know anything about Darkseid, you know Darkseid's always been looking for or trying to use the life equation. Or not the life equation, the anti-life equation. And so Highfather, always trying to counter him to keep him from this knowledge, now has a chance to finally beat Darkseid by claiming the life equation and using it to ultimately defeat Darkseid. That's the situation. And so he sends out his generals to claim one of each of the rings, which is where we get our initial conflict. And so we have all the lanterns getting their rings stolen, and this is leading to a lot of death because you have to kill a lantern most of the time to take the ring. Especially in the case of the red lanterns. So there's our initial setup, and the cores have to work together to go attack the new gods because they are just absolutely, completely ineffective against the new gods. There's this fan-fucking-tastic scene between Metron and Metron, Orion, and the Green Lantern Corps attacking them at the Source Wall. And they just unload a freaking barrage upon the new gods. The Green Lanterns, all of them attack in force, and it does jack shit against them. Absolutely ineffected, unaffected by the attack of the Green Lantern Corps. And Metron goes, "Confirm something for me, Mobius Chair. Are these the most powerful weapons in this universe?" And he goes, "Accurate." And then Orion just hands the Green Lantern Corps their ass. Just on a friggin' silver platter, just hands the Green Lantern Corps their collective ass. A lot of lanterns end up dead because of it. And so we have really friggin' high stakes for the Green Lantern Corps here. Sinestro does some cool shit in this. I'm a little iffy on him, but I'll get to that. The Green Lantern Corps go and settle on Korugar. That's where everyone's convening to deal with new gods. And there's just this amazing scene between... before I get to that. What I like about the stakes of this are the fact that there are stakes. Like, with the Green Lantern run, nothing's ever been easy for them to overcome, but it's really often come down to, well, we just have to unite as a core and hit them with a bunch of energy all at once, and then we'll be victorious. That's how a lot of the John stuff ends, and it's always satisfying, but it's a little repetitive. So here, that's where we start. They seriously, like, the first major conflict besides just the blitz attack, the drive-by the new gods perform, the first major conflict is the majority of the Green Lantern Corps throwing everything they've got right at the new gods as a united front, and it does jack shit. I really like that. I really, really, really like that. So anyway, we have the, we have Hal looking into seeing if he can find anything out about, High Father. Excuse me. And then Sinestro and Hal dealing, like, meaning out their shit. Sinestro's thrown Hal to the ground. "Look at you. You call yourself a leader. You're a disgrace. The great Hal Jordan, cowed and following the commands of others. Blunted. No edge at all. It's no mystery why your beloved lanterns have been slaughtered on your watch. Why the universe now reviles them. Damn you, Sinestro. Always plotting, always scheming. You strike me in my house, you stand on unfriendly ground here. What can I say? You bring out my impulsive side." "Of course I do. That's the reason I allowed you to come here. Tell me, Jordan, how does it feel to not think. You're deranged. Hardly. I know what I am and what I am not. Do you remember what I said to you when last we fought a common foe? You said we'd always be friends. I didn't believe you then, and I sure as hell don't believe you now. Do you know what allows a friendship as tumultuous as ours to endure? It isn't the traits we have in common. It's the traits that set us apart. The traits we admire in each other because we don't see them in ourselves. The time I spent training you when I was a lantern, the times we battled after I left the Corps, the blackest nights and the brightest days. Do you know why I could never kill you? You were too blasted unpredictable. Set a plotter and a schemer in my path and I'll crush their bones to dust. You've escaped that fate not because of something as silly as willpower, nor because of your prosaic notions of justice and morality. You've survived because your actions never make sense, yet despite yourself, and this is truly the infuriating part, your instincts always see you through. Now with the universe on the precipice, you consult maps and databases. You're following orders of all things. Tell me, did you craft a strategy before engaging the enemy at the source wall? Yeah? Were you victorious? Wouldn't have come here if I wasn't. If I was. How long have I sought to break you? You went and broke yourself. It would require no effort to kill you now. A mere glint of my ring, but I need you. Not this new version, I need the prior you. For all our sakes, you better still have it in you. The guardians are right. Everyone has to move. The new gods will find you here. That is already taken care of. You focus on your job. So, you're saying you admire me. And Sinestro walks away, rolling his eyes. That's perfect. I love them together. Just this really... How do I put it? I love them having this really tense, uncomfortable, Magneto Professor Xavier style friendship, where they're always inches away from coming to blows, but for some reason they're always having to work together. Really, really love that about them. Black Hand's fucking creepy as shit, again. And that's awesome. We get... Any Dick Grayson fans listening? So Black Bolt Mask resurrects an entire circus, including the audience, just for his entertainment. And the ringleader goes, "For our next performance, the death-defying theatrics of the Flying Graysons!" We have zombie Monpa Grayson about ready to do what do you call that? The trapeze, there we go. Anyway, so like one, the mom grabs the trapeze bar, and because she's a fucking rotting corpse, her arms snap off halfway through. Really great stuff. Just totally fucked. Anyway. So, Hal is now working with Black Hand, while Sinestro and John are trying to get all as many members of the other corps together as they can, and deal with a strategy to unite against the new gods. Doop 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 doop. John Stewart goes Star Sapphire. That was kind of cool. Oh, and I didn't mention this earlier, but I actually took a picture of this and posted it on Twitter. There's a really good scene between John Stewart and one of the new gods. Oh, where's it at? I really want to get the line right. It's a little bit after that. Okay, so new gods are standing around. And John tells the other lanterns to leave, and while he faces them on their own, on his own. And Newgat says, "Noble, sacrificing yourself, but ultimately pointless." And John says, "I've never been big on sacrifices. The thing that a lot of people don't know about architects is that we aren't just builders," and he shoots a bunch of chains out of his ring. "Before we can create something, the chains wrap around, like, you know, the ruins of buildings above them. We have to tear the old. We have to tear down the old." And he collapses the buildings on top of the new gods and takes off. I really like that. Yeah, John Stewart goes Star Sapphire. That's kind of a cool one. Cool little moment. It's just to get them out of the situation, but it looks pretty cool. So I've talked a lot about the Green Lanterns. So what's going on with the new gods? Why are they against each other besides just stealing the rings? Well, they steal the rings really easily. That happens within the first two issues, that all the rings are collected. Highfather puts all the rings together and wants to use them to create, to make mortals into gods in order, gods subservient to him, in order to fight Darkseid. He tests it out on the largest populace in the DC universe, just some random sci-fi planet. Turns every single member of the population into just horrid, god-awful monsters that, honestly, the only course of action that's merciful is to put them down, because otherwise they'll die slowly and in pain. There's some really interesting stuff, and I mean, it's right on the nose. It's not subtle, but it doesn't have to be. The whole point about this, the thing that they keep demonstrating, and I think the thing that'll bother people the most, but I still feel it's done really well. The point that they're demonstrating here is that Highfather has completely lost sense of himself and lost his way, and is just as bad as Darkseid now. And it's not subtle. There are people kind of bringing it up. New gods are saying, "Oh wow, he's just, we left one tyrant to go to another. That can't be." They're just dealing with the fact that Highfather is becoming Darkseid in his quest for the ability to defeat Darkseid, to the point where he doesn't even recognize what he's doing. Like, he eventually gets the life equation in this and is able to change a populace into foot soldiers for him. And they have no thoughts of their own. They act only for Highfather. They have no will of their own. Their will is only to serve Highfather and his goals. And he does that to lanterns, and they immediately turn on their cores, their respective cores, and they are just as problematic now. They're zapped of all will. And so it's not subtle, but Highfather still just doesn't see it. He's so focused on his endgame, on ending Darkseid, that he doesn't see the evil he himself is committing. He doesn't see that he is becoming Darkseid by doing all this. And that's, you know, there's a lot of fine plot details and stuff and cool moments that I'll just let you pick up on your own. The Kyle Rayner stuff in here is fantastic. Everybody gets something to do here. All the Human Lanterns, as it normally is. Not entirely, but everyone gets a great story here. Hal gets back to his roots about being Hal Jordan again, as opposed to trying to take on the responsibility of being the, like, thinking that being the leader of the Green Lantern Corps means that he has to change the way in which he goes about things. Guy Gardner comes to terms with losing people in battle, and Simon Baz is the one that gets him there. John Stewart got that really cool moment with the damn architecture thing, and he's a great team leader in this again. He's actually got a character that doesn't involve fucking killing another Lantern. And Kyle Rayner got to do some shit too. It was fucking great. Kyle Rayner got to learn how to take, how to truly understand and deal with the responsibility of his new powers, the White Lantern, his reality bending capabilities. But anyway, we get to the end here. Oh, before we get to the end, there's one other two other jaw-dropping, awesome, amazing moments that I just adored. So, Hal goes and gets Blackhand, and they start fighting Orion and the New Gods at the Source Wall again. And as they're fighting at the Source Wall, Blackhand gets distracted and is just kind of falling in love with the Source Wall because it's a mass grave. And that's leading to Hal getting his ass handed to him by the New Gods again. And seriously, he's just staring at the mass grave. So Hal says to him as he's staring down Orion, Blackhand, now would be a great time to call in your Black Lanterns. Seems like so breathtaking. Orion goes, him I actually like. Finally, one of you glow bugs crazy enough to have a drink with. Blackhand touches the Source Wall, which you're not supposed to do. Blackhand touches the Source Wall. The blackest night. Ugh. Don't touch the wall, you idiot. The blackest night falls from the skies. The darkness grows as all light dies. How? Oh my. Orion. Gods. How is he resisting? Everything that touches the wall becomes the wall. Blackhand. I crave your hearts and your demise. By my black hand, the dead shall. Rise. The entire Source Wall comes back to life to be the army of the Lanterns. That's fucking awesome. I saw Blackhand looking at the Source Wall, and I did not put two and two together that he would have the ability to resurrect all of them. That didn't even cross my mind for half a fucking second. Jaw dropped at that moment. Just one of those awesome, fucking amazing moments that you just never see. Just one of those fucking awesome moments that you only see in Green Lantern, where it's just something so unbelievably cool happens that you cannot help but cheer for it. I fucking adored this. So anyway, they take the armies of the dead and go to fight the New Gods. And it's New Genesis is getting fucking rocked by all this shit. It's a goddamn war zone. Which, once again, you don't get to see very often. So really neat, clever ideas. And Highfather has no concern over it. He's sure he can beat it. Kyle's trying to talk Highfather down or trying to overpower him. He's getting tortured in the process. And then Hal has this great moment. Stop. Don't you see something wrong? Taking people's free will, starting a war that will kill billions. All this, Highfather, just to create an army to beat Darkseid? Don't you get it? You're becoming Darkseid. And all it took was someone to say it. And Highfather really got it at that point. It's not subtle, it's not simple, it is a little predictable. I saw that coming throughout the entire book, but I don't care. This was so well told, and it's completely believable. If you were the one playing a battle of wits with Darkseid for eons, he'd rub off on you. The idea that the ends justify the means, and to have Metron, who's just this... Metron is like the embodiment of empiricism. He don't give a damn what the outcome is, as long as he gets to observe it. I really like that. So you got Metron whispering in your ear there, just trying to figure out what happens if you... Like, this is all just a fun little experiment for Metron to see what kinds of powers, what kinds of capabilities do these rings really have. So, in bringing all this war and destruction to New Genesis, the floating city starts to drop. Kyle gets his power back and goes and saves the day. Not sure about this panel. For such a cool moment, I was a little disappointed by the artwork there. Not gonna lie. Especially since it gets so much better in the next couple panels. Anyway. So, Kyle saves... Kyle gets rid of all the creatures from the Source Wall. As the city falls. And Saint Walker, who was without a ring, without the ability to use his ring, even before this all started. And he looks up and he sees Kyle, and he's like, the power of life endures. Endures. And Hal goes to try to stop the city from falling, because now it's a matter of, you know, we have to work together, we have to be allies, because we cannot let war break out again. Sinestro's telling him, what is it? Today the children of your enemies are only children. Tomorrow they will be your enemies. Highfather brought this war upon his people. His errant use of the life equation ruined his own city. Who are we to intervene with divinity? If you want to run, run. Oh, wait, Hal goes, my god, we have to help them, and Sinestro just wants to look on. No, our heels are at our enemy's throats. We have to stomp down. He wants the city to be completely destroyed. So Hal goes to try his best just to lend his effort to supporting New Genesis, and he's just trying everything he can with constructs to hold it up. And as Kyle Rayner, like, looks like it almost took it out of him, but he's alive. And St. Walker goes, Kyle Rayner has done his work. When I heard my friend, the White Lantern, had died, I lost my way. When I learned that rings of every hue drain the energy that fuels creation, I lost my hope. But the White Lantern lives, as he did once. He can replenish the reservoir anew. As long as there exists such a being in the universe, all will be well. And St. Walker gets to be the Blue Lantern again. And then Hal's down there, as he's pushing himself as hard as he can, using all of his will to hold up that city. Ring suddenly goes, power level 300%. Welcome back, St. Walker. That's just fucking awesome. It's literally Hal Jordan is holding the entire city up in the air. And he's able to, with the help of the cores, set it down safely so that no one died. And, you know, they say their goodbyes. Highfather realizes the error of his ways and we get to build anew. Mogo gets his ring back. I was disappointed Mogo didn't get to be involved more directly in this story. Mogo gets his ring back. And then we're left with a tease for what's going on with the Source Wall for the next story. Like I say, this was gold to me. this was one of the best Green Lantern stories I've ever read. I love what Geoff Johns did with Green Lantern. He did some amazing work. But he also had certain issues that were very telling as he developed it. I really think that besides the Rise of the Third Army into the Wrath of the First Lantern story, and again, I'll read it in trade and see if I like it more now that I've gotten a lot of distance from it, is probably the most telling of John's inability to end a story. Green Lantern in the End was good, but I was still really displeased with Wrath of the First Lantern. It's just really telling of Johns' inability to end a story arc. So when we get... but I think that this was hinted at a lot earlier on with Blackest Night into Brightest Day. I think that was always really his biggest problem with writing Green Lantern and stuff. So I really like Johns, but more than anything, I like what Johns did for the character. And I like a lot of the stuff that we've gotten since then. As far as Green Lantern stuff goes, I'll say post-Johns, and that means not just post-stuff that was published after Johns took over, but post-what Johns did to change the universe, so things that were actually picking up on and leading away from Johns. Green Lantern, the animated series, this, Geoff Johns' work. I adored this that much. I thought it was absolutely fantastic. So let me talk just for a minute, though, about the New Gods, because that's going to be a lot of people's problem with this, is the depiction of the New Gods. Because when you hear Green Lantern, New Gods, you think Green Lantern Corps versus Darkseid and Apocalypse with Highfather backing them up. No. Darkseid's involved in this story, but not directly. Darkseid doesn't do shit in this story but be Darkseid and exist in the background of Highfather's mind. There's exactly one time where a version of Darkseid does anything in the entire story besides sit there and look badass, and that is when Sinestro confronts him and throws a Yellow Lantern Darkseid construct at Highfather. So, no, this is a story where the New Gods are the villains, and that will bother people. But the New Gods have always been very dispassionate, very removed and distant from the affairs of mortals. They've very often been depicting as just not really caring about mortals, but just caring about defeating Darkseid. And so... if you really, really like the New Gods being the Superman to Darkseid's Lex Luthor, the Batman to Darkseid's Joker, you're not going to enjoy this. They are the villains of this book, but they're not... They do kill an entire planet. That part's pretty unavoidable. Two entire planets. Highfather is responsible for, removing all life on two planets. That being said, though, you have Kyle Rayner in this, who is now a reality bender, on par with, like, he has the capability, as we see in this, to do things on par with Mixoplick and Batmite as far as just altering reality. So you could have had him fix that, but they don't. And that's important. So the New Gods aren't irredeemable after this. But you actually get to, I kind of like that. I kind of like that, or no, the New Gods are irredeemable, sorry. They have committed some really big fucking sins. Two genocides, it's a lot of genocides. I know it doesn't sound like a lot of genocides, but trust me, two genocides is enough. So the New Gods certainly aren't heroic anymore, but I would make the argument that after Jack Kirby, they never were. They were the good guys in Jack Kirby's original thing, but still, that's, you know, it's one thing to look at when a character or universe or whatever was created. It's another to look at how they've been used. And most of the time they've been used as the cavalry to come in and save the Earth or whatever from the evils of Darkseid. And so this is a continuation of that, where that's all they care about is stopping Darkseid. They don't care about people. They don't care who they affect. They're looking at the larger picture, the casualties of a war kind of situation. So yeah, it gets pretty complicated here. And so if you just absolutely cannot stand the New Gods being used in that way, I more than understand not wanting to read this. But if you are like me, if you do believe that, you know, fighting monsters can turn you into a monster, it's not that hard to swallow. It is good character play position. And the important thing here is they learn. They learn from their mistake. Yes, Highfather committed genocide, and he's going to still remain in power, but he's going to be taking that lesson with him. He's going to be learning from the mistake that he made. And I find that really interesting, really compelling, and an interesting evolution of the character. He's clearly in the wrong the whole time, though. And like I say, it's not subtle. It's not slowly built in. It is really obvious from some of the first couple scenes of Highfather in this. They go back to New Genesis, and Highfather's talking about his plan to, or what to do with the rings, and you see them walk past a group of school children, and there's video of Highfather playing in this group of school children. Must never allow Apocalypse to gain control of the multiverse. Darkseid's agents will enslave all, allowing no creature in the... Haley is here. Allowing no creature the freedom to choose its own fate, every new god must prepare to defend against his parademons. Have you not seen the sun-bleached bones of your forebears far below us, amid the ruins of Genesis? They fought a lesson that you must bury in your hearts, my flowers. Darkseid will grant no mercy. He's like, he's playing that for children. He has become power mad. He has become paranoid and harsh because of Darkseid. And I find that really fascinating. And I think it's cool to do with Green Lantern to show him hope and fear, to show them what those emotions can do to you when taken to extremes, and how to be better for it. And yeah, I think that's the lesson he learns here, and it's not subtle, but it's not overstated either. He sees what he's becoming, he immediately realizes how awful that is, and he immediately takes steps to reverse that. I really enjoy that about it. So if you can't look past just that he is doing awful things, I think that's a little unfair, but I get it. It really worked for me, though. So yeah, that will do it for this week's episode of Comic Reviews. That was a long one. I'm really happy to find good Green Lantern again. I was really disappointed in that. Over the next couple months, I'll probably buy the trades from After Blackest Night on and start talking about those. Or maybe I should just do John's entire run. You know, Steve and I and Bill, hopefully, are planning to do an episode of Geeky Gentlemen talking about the Alan Moore Green Lantern stories. And since all of John's stuff kind of spirals out of that, and Emerald Twilight, I may just start talking about all the books on this show. I'm
all John's Green Lantern stuff and on. And the stuff that was really important and leading up to that. I did promise to talk about Zero Hour, and I just never got to it. Yeah, I'll do that too. That'll be my next series of trades for a while, like I did with Sandman a while back. I'll do a bunch of the Green Lantern stuff that leads up to this. And I may get back to this again and talk about it a second time. With all the post-John stuff in mind to see if there's anything else interesting I find about it. So, yeah, look forward to those. And that's it, everyone. Thank you for sitting there listening to me talk about just Godhead for an hour almost. I think this will be the longest episode of Comic Reviews, so I'm going to go ahead and end it. Now, if you have any single issues and monthly series that are coming out that you would like me to pick up, please leave those in the comments below. I will do my best to get a hold of at least one issue, and if I like it enough, I will add it to my pull list and continue to talk about it. If you have any trades, graphic novels that you would like me to keep an eye out for and pick up when I'm in the store, please leave those in the comments below, and I'll keep an eye out for them. Or if you'd like to send me something in the mail, please leave that in the comments below, and we'll work out some situation. Till next time, everyone. Bye!